Good morning, friends. Happy Mother's Day. I bought you flowers. I was thinking about Mother's Day this morning and how when I was growing up, Mother's Day was a big deal. And corsages were sold, and my dad would always go get my mom and I a red corsage of carnations or roses. And if your mother wasn't living anymore, you got a white orchid or white roses. I don't see that so much anymore these days. So I wasn't sure, so I just bought you a whole bouquet. And I wanted to tell you that there are some people in our congregation and our community of faith that don't have children. And yet we want to wish you a happy Mother's Day, because whether you have children or not, the women of this congregation have been so incredibly nurturing and loving and kind to everyone, to our children, to our adults, to everybody in our congregation, and all of the things that mothering represents. I want to wish all of you happy Mother's Day, and thank you for the gifts that you bring and the love and the tenderness that you bring to me and to our community of faith. Have a wonderful day. Come on, let's go to church.
Please join me in our call to worship. We gather together to worship our loving, nurturing God, who, like a mother, knows us intimately, loves us unconditionally, teaches us the way we should go, and comforts us in times of need. Praise God, the source and sustainer of life.
Hi, boys and girls. Today is a very special day. You might already know what day it is because your mom, that's a clue, might have already told you, but today is Mother's Day. So be sure to wish your mom a happy Mother's Day. But before we get to that, we're going to come back to talking about our moms, but I wanted to talk about one very special mom. And usually we talk about this mom during Christmas time. So before I show you the book, I wanted to see if anyone knows the answer. What special mom do we talk about during Christmas? Mary, that's right. And some of you might have remembered that from our pageant time or singing about Mary and baby Jesus. But I want to show you just a lovely little picture right here, right? We have Mother Mary laying her little baby Jesus in the manger. And I have another picture to show you. There's a lot of different illustrations about what people think Mary might have looked like. And here's another one that I thought was really pretty. Can you see her? We have Mary and also Joseph and baby Jesus. So I wanted us to remember Mary today, because I think it's a wonderful thing that God thought mothers were so important that he wanted baby Jesus to have one as well. And I think that's just a wonderful thing to remember, that God wants us to love our moms. And even though it's not in this picture, we're going to fast forward in Jesus' life, right? So we just celebrated Easter. But what happened right before Easter? Does anybody know? On the Friday before Easter. This might be a tough one. Can anybody tell me? It was Good Friday, right? When Jesus died for our sins on the cross. But when he was on the cross, he actually said something to his mom. And he said that he wanted one of his disciples to take care of her. And it's just a beautiful way that Jesus was honoring his mom. Honoring just means loving and respecting. And that's what today is all about. So I hope that today you can wish your mom a happy Mother's Day. But I also wanted you to think, when you tell her Happy Mother's Day, maybe also include one thing that you love about your mom. And make sure you tell her that, and just to say thank you for all that she's done. And let's just close in prayer together as we thank God for our moms. And you can pray after me. Thank you, God, for our mothers. Thank you, God, for their love. Help us to show them our love back, today and always. Amen. Thank you, boys and girls. See you next time. Our scripture reading from this morning is from Isaiah chapter 66, verses 7 through 13. Hear now the word of the Lord. Before she goes into labor, she gives birth. Before the pains come upon her, she delivers a son. Who has ever heard of such things? Who has ever seen things like this? Can a country be born in a day? Or a nation brought forth in a moment? Yet no sooner is Zion in labor than she gives birth to her children. Do I bring to the moment of birth and not give delivery, says the Lord? Do I close up the womb when I bring to delivery, says your God? Rejoice with Jerusalem and be glad for her, all you who love her. Rejoice greatly with her, all you who mourn over her. For you will nurse and be satisfied at her comforting breasts. You will drink deeply and delight in her overflowing abundance. For this is what the Lord says, I will extend peace to her like a river, and the wealth of nations like a flooding stream. You will nurse and be carried on her arm and dandled on her knees. As a mother comforts her child, so I will comfort you, and you will be comforted in Jerusalem. This is the word of the Lord. Thanks be to God. Will you pray with me? Lord, may the words of my mouth and the meditations of all of our hearts be acceptable in thy sight. O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. You were crying that day. You don't remember it, but you were. You reached out with eyes closed, beat red in the face from tears of pain, tears of joy, and you took in your first breath. And your tears matched your mother's as this divine water flowed from both of you as you found each other. Even though you had been together for 9 months, you found each other. The one you knew and loved more than life itself, you finally saw them face to face. You are only here now, sitting in your homes, enjoying your Sunday morning cup of coffee, because you were carried in your mother's womb and were brought into this world through her pain. But it was worth it for her because she had you. She held you in her arms and probably wept at the sight of your beautiful face the first time she saw you. She knew your movements, the feeling of you, your patterns, more intimately than she ever knew herself. And finally, you were brought into the world through her love and through her pain. And that is the only reason why you exist. So hello, good morning, and happy Mother's Day. That was not my way of guilting you into calling your mother today, which you should. But it was my way of reminding us of how we got here. And this reality is still very fresh for me. It was only 5 months ago that I gave birth to my daughter, Annabelle. And the experience of it was so earth-shattering that I'll never forget it as long as I live. You could wake me up out of a dead sleep decades from now, and I'd be able to recall every minute with exacting clarity. And that is because it was beautiful, and it was painful. Being a mother has blown up in my understanding of how much God loves us, and it rattles my mind to think that God could possibly love us more than a mother loves her child. In fact, our love for our children is just a pale and pathetic reflection of God's unfathomably deep love for us. We cannot understand all that God does in love for us, all that God has already done. In the same way, I never realized until I had a child myself how much it took for my parents to care for me as a baby. The endless sacrifices they made, the confusion about what to do, the exhaustion, the hours, the physical demands it puts on you, I never knew that my parents had done that for me. I called my mom one night, it was a few months after giving birth, and we talked for a while, and I told her I was just so awed and thankful for what she had done. That someone had cared about me enough to do all that for me, to rock me to sleep, to suffer through sleepless nights, to care for me when I was sick, to anticipate my needs far before I could, to love me with so much dedication, so much vigilance, so much perseverance. And here's the catch. I don't even remember. All of that love she poured into me, all of those sacrifices she made for me, all the songs she sang for me, or the nights she laid on the floor of the nursery just so I wouldn't feel alone, I don't even remember. But she did it without thanks. But what kept her going through these endless days that turned into nights, that turned into days, like all parents? Was it not the mother of us all? The mother of all mothers? The one who neither slumbers nor sleeps? The one who protects like a mighty lion? The one who made the biggest sacrifice of all? And it is tragic that, well, there are many more times in Scripture when God is seen as Father, the times God is portrayed as Mother are often ignored. In lesser-known passages of the Bible, God is described as a mother hen gathering her chicks beneath her wings, a protective mother bear over her cubs, a mother eagle, a nursing mother, a woman in labor, a woman giving birth, though we don't hear these passages very often. Similarly, in our scripture for today, in the book of Isaiah, God is referred to as a comforting mother, one who never abandons us. Here, Isaiah is addressing that Judah has been taken captive by the Babylonians. But Isaiah's prophecy is meant to comfort those in exile, to tell them that God has not forgotten them, and God will restore them to Jerusalem and bring them home. But this is not a process without pain. He uses the metaphor of labor when he says that this time of exile is like labor pains, that even though it hurts right now, that the pain will bring about an incomprehensible joy. He says, before she goes into labor, she gives birth. Before the pains come upon her, she delivers a son. Who has ever heard of such things? Who has even seen things like this? God is speaking through Isaiah to say that as a child is only born through labor pain, so are you to be delivered from exile only through pain. But God brings reassurance in promising yet again that this deliverance is secure. He says, do I bring to the moment of birth and not give delivery, says the Lord? Do I close up the womb when I bring to delivery, says your God? No, there is pain, but the birth is coming, and it will be worth it. It won't have been for nothing. All these pangs will birth Israel's restoration and redemption. And throughout all of this, even throughout the pain, God is present as a comforting mother to Israel. And not just any mother, the mother of mothers, reaching out with reassurance to those far away to bring them close. Now, while we are not as far away as those who were in Babylon, some days it feels just as far when we are apart from one another. Some days, though we are only streets away from our friends and family, we might as well be nations apart. It is our exile. It is our exile from our community, from our friends, from our routines, from our work, our play, our sources of fulfillment and joy, our life, and sometimes it feels like our very selves. We're so far away. And it's a sad day when 6 feet of social distancing might as well be 60,000. This is our exile. And we lament like the Israelites did because there is nothing new under the sun. We cry out for one another. We cry out to be restored. But Isaiah's prophecy reassures Jerusalem that this will be so for them. Continuing with the motherly metaphor, he says, rejoice with Jerusalem and be glad for her, all you who love her. Rejoice greatly with her, all you who mourn. Isaiah is saying to the Israelites, the pain will come to an end, and you will be born into a new joy, as you are made into a new creation, and all the while, even amidst the pangs and the pain, you're comforted by the love of the one who made you. You will not be forgotten in your pain, but the pain will produce a gladness only tears can express. This word does not only speak to the Israelites in Babylon, but it speaks to us in our homes. It speaks into our isolation. This call to rejoice is a fresh word of hope breathed into the stale air of our sheltering in place. It's a warm fire held up to the cold reality of our exile. We too feel these pains, and they also feel like they will never end or produce nothing but the ache of sadness that's already there. But they are not pains like that. They are not pains like that from a wound, but pains like that from a new beginning. Just as you were close and yet far from your mother in the womb before birth, one day soon we too will see each other face to face and find each other again. You were crying that day. You don't remember it, but you were. And your tears matched your mother's, and they matched God's too. Our Comforter, who truly is, at the end of all things, one God and Mother of us all. Amen.
This morning, before I lead us in our call to stewardship, I wanted to point out our bulletin board, our information board, on which we affix thank you letters that come from many different organizations, locally, nationally, and internationally. Organizations that our Mission and Service Committee and our sessions support on behalf of the church. In addition to the many letters that are behind me, our presbytery, the Presbytery of Philadelphia, continues to help out smaller, struggling churches in our presbytery. Up until now, I think about $200,000 worth of grants have been issued to any number of churches in our presbytery that are struggling financially. So if you're able to give, obviously your giving will reach many, many individuals and organizations that need our help right now. Our Lord blesses us and lifts us up with his sustaining power of new creation. Let us give back to God out of our abundance, that our resources may be used to usher in God's kingdom of love and grace. And let us do so. My friends, let us dedicate our offerings. God of our lives, we offer to you these gifts, trusting that you will weave them into your tapestry of grace that you show a hurting world. Bless these resources and use them to multiply your mercies out into our community and world to bring aid to those who need it most. In Christ's name, amen. Let us unite our hearts in prayer, saying, God of resurrection, hear our prayer. For the church throughout the world, that all who profess to honor the risen Lord may be faithful in their witness and courageous in their testimony to the way of Jesus. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. For pastors, teachers, and ministers, that by the power of the Holy Spirit they may seek to build the church upon Christ, the cornerstone, and humbly lead in faithful service. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. For the governments of the world and its leaders, especially for our own president and governor, that the nations may dwell in peace, that goodwill prevail over strife, and people of faith may freely worship as their hearts direct. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. For rain and sun in proper measure, and for abundant food and water for all who dwell upon the earth. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. For the sick and those in need, and for any who are oppressed by wounds of the soul, and especially for those in our own community that need our prayers, for our neighbors, that we may live together in amity, and that strangers among us may find us to be hospitable friends. God of resurrection, hear our prayers. And O Lord, we pray especially today for Ken and his family, for Ella, for Owen, for Bryn, for Kenneth, Dave, and John, for MK, for Doris, for Calvin and Phoebe, for Liliana, for Viola, for Cynthia, for Holly. And Lord, for our missionaries, Charles and Melissa, John and Jenny, God of resurrection, hear our prayer. And hear now our silent petitions as we offer them to you. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. And Lord, for our enemies, that their sins may be forgiven them and that they may find your peace. God of resurrection, hear our prayer. Almighty God, your Son promised to grant whatever we ask in his name. By your Holy Spirit, empower us to minister to the world as his faithful disciples, that our work may testify to what we pray and show forth your eternal glory. Through Jesus Christ, our Lord. Amen. And I want to add this prayer for this time of this unordinary time in which we live. Almighty God, we are weary and anxious. We are exhausted and overwhelmed. Our quarantine fatigue grows even though we want to do what is right for the sake of the most vulnerable among us. We wonder how long this season of social distancing will last. While we are eager to be together, to get back to the routines and activities we once took for granted, we do not want to endanger any of your beloved children or risk an even higher death toll. Our sorrow over our losses persists despite our faith in your promise of a good future and abundant life. We lament missed milestones, jobs lost, loved ones sick, lives disrupted, resources stretched, essential workers heavily burdened, and far too many people dead and buried without the rituals of grief that offer us comfort. We pray, God of grace, for patience in the present moment. Give us the ability to abide in you when we feel as if we cannot abide this painful season 1 minute longer. We plead for wisdom. As leaders in every realm of our communal life face the complex decisions of when to ease our isolation and how to begin to return to work and school and travel and church. Grant them all discernment that takes into account the least of these, the priceless value of each person, and our obligation to love our neighbor as ourselves. Send your Spirit to witness to your truth, O Lord, to remind us of all Jesus taught, and to unite us inextricably to you and to each other. It is in Christ's name that we pray, that same Christ who taught his disciples to say when they pray, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom and the power and the glory forever. Amen.
Be with you all.
too. Crashed my car, I was 17. My mother in the seat riding next to me. The things I've learned from a broken mirror. How a face can change when a heart knows fear. For all the things my eyes have seen, the best by far is you. If I could fly, then I would know what life looks like from up above and down below. I keep you safe, I keep you dry. Don't be afraid, Cecilia, I'm the satellite, and you're the sky. And you're the star.